CNN's Chris Cuomo has meltdown after being called out for fake news. This needs to end. CNN was exposed as fake news network that it is this week when it was forced to retract a fake story alleging links between former Trump transition team member Anthony Scaramucci and the Russian Direct Investment Fund. Now it appears that everyone at CNN is feeling the heat over this, as Chris Cuomo just had a meltdown on his own program about being accused of spreading fake news. Really, Chris? Breitbart reported that on Wednesday, Cuomo was talking about the Senate GOP's health care bill with Senator Ron Johnson, an opponent of the bill, when the CNN host decried the fake thing after Johnson said that numbers being used to attack the Republican effort were incorrect. We need information, and the debate on this thing has been completely distorted using incorrect information, Johnson said. This clearly hit a nerve in Cuomo because his response was incredibly aggressive. I know you're not suggesting that I'm using misleading information, right? No, really, Chris? You let me know what I'm saying that is inaccurate, Cuomo said, because this whole fake thing needs to end, and it needs to end right now. You tell me what I'm getting wrong, or we'll deal with the number as the CBO is putting them out. I'm not accusing you. I'm talking about the fact that people don't understand the 22 million was a wrong baseline, Johnson replied. Clearly, CNN hosts like Cuomo don't like that they've been exposed for reporting fake news. Share this story if you think CNN is a fake news network. We all know that, but isn't it lovely to see them squeal? Let's take a listen here.
Voters pass a health care bill or live with Obamacare. So what changes need to be made to the bill to win over senators who are against it? Let's get after it. We've got Senator Ron Johnson of Wisconsin. He was at that meeting with President Trump. He opposes the current Senate bill. Senator, always a pleasure to have you on New Day. Thank you for taking the opportunity. So what do you need to see in this bill, and what do you think the chance is right now that you can get there?
Well, Chris, again, let me first correct the record. I've never said I opposed the Senate bill, and I was going to vote no. It was a very hard no on taking it up and voting this week, because okay, we simply didn't have the information. Now we're starting to get the information. Let me break some news here. You know, the headline figure that the first year 15 million Americans would lose coverage, that's based on a March 2016 baseline, a year and 3 months old. CBO actually has a January 2017 baseline, and one of the components, the individual non-group market, there's no difference. And according to CBO, 7 million of the 15 million were out of that individual market. They were projecting 26 million people would have coverage under the new baseline. 18 million or 19 million people are going to have it, which is the exact same projection under the Senate bill. So there'd be no people, if you actually compare this against a more up-to-date baseline, that lose coverage. That is big news in terms of the debate. Plus, the Senate bill with CBO score literally saves another $200 billion in terms of spending or deficit reduction. That $200 billion will give us, I think, maneuvering room to find the votes. And let me throw one last little fact at you. I keep hearing people talk about we're slashing Medicaid. In 2008, we spent $200 billion on Medicaid. This year, we'll spend close to $400 billion. We've doubled it. What Republicans are trying to do, and again, other people saying we want to, you know, our goal is to take people off coverage. No, we want premiums to come down so more Americans can afford coverage, so the American taxpayer have to spend less in subsidies. We want to save Medicaid, and we want to stop mortgaging our children's future. That's what we're trying to accomplish. But the Democrats and Obamacare left us a big mess. It's not easy to fix.
Well, the argument is you're not getting it done, that this bill doesn't bring premiums down in any realistic way, in any way you want to term the reduction in funds to Medicaid. And again, it's a political judgment, but a practical reality will be less money in the system, less money to the states, less of a match, less means you're going to have less people covered.
You hear that from governors from
both parties all over this country.
Less means actually spending less year over year. And in this projection, there's only 1 year where spending on Medicaid goes down a little bit, then it keeps progressing upwards. So,
right, but costs are going up. You're not dealing with it in a vacuum, Senator. I know you're a businessman, and you get the economic principles here well.
Let's talk about the premium projections. The CBO says the first year premiums, compared to the baseline, be higher, 20% higher. Again, that's largely because we give people the freedom to choose whether or not they want to buy this grossly expensive Obamacare now, and they choose not to do so. The next year, it's 10% above baseline, which means the second year already premiums are coming down. By the third year, premiums are 30% below the baseline, and that's just by removing primarily one of those market reforms is causing all that reduction in premiums, and that's what I've been arguing. Get rid of all the market reforms, give Americans the freedom and insurance companies to design products that people can afford that suit their needs, and we won't be spending so much money on subsidies, and people will have, in terms of net effect, in terms of premiums, they won't be harmed.
But
need information, and the debate on this thing has been completely distorted using incorrect information.
Well, two things about that. First of all, one thing. I know you're not suggesting that I'm using misleading information, right?
You let me know
what I'm saying that's inaccurate. Because
this whole
fake thing needs to end, and it needs to end right now. Chris, tell me what I'm getting wrong, or we'll deal with the numbers.
I'm not accusing you. I'm talking about the fact people don't understand the 22 million, and there's a wrong baseline. And then the way the premiums are reported, you have to really understand the way economists take a look at this and what's really happening.
No, I get it, but practical concepts. And I know you're a businessman, and I know where your head is on this, and I know you're in good faith, which is why I invite you on the show so often. I want your perspective on this. But on the premium side, let's just take a look at that for a second, because that's what you were talking about, okay? This is from the CBO score, just simple red and green arrows. I don't know if you can see it where you are, but, they go up the first couple of years, and then they start going down. There is a fundamental principle here, leaving the numbers to the side. You want to buy the insurance that just you need at that time. And if you're young, you want really nothing as long as you can because you're healthy, thank God. That's all fine, but that's not how insurance works. And if you don't pool coverage and you don't have people, even if they don't need something specifically, adding their risk into that pool, it is really unaffordable for those who do need it. There is a little bit of a shared sacrifice principle for insurance costs to work.
And the good news is you can actually pool those high risk, those high cost condition patients.
And that's expensive.
But you can do it without driving up premiums on the individual market. I wrote an article in the New York Times.
Go ahead, Senator.
Bill Clinton was talking about these people that are busting at working 16 hours a week, winding up with premiums doubled, I'll add tripled in some cases, and the coverage cut in half. Those are the forgotten men and women. Those are the people we're trying to bring premiums down, and you can do that. You can cover people with pre-existing conditions without collapsing insurance markets. Look at the main example where they had guaranteed issue. It drove the premiums up, I think, by double. Then they instituted an invisible high-risk pool, and those premiums were pretty well cut in half, according to one study. So the bottom line is we can do this, but we need the information. The problem in Washington, D.C. is we talk policy absent and void of information, and that was my problem with the process, is it started with all these policy arguments void of any information. We finally have some information, one CBO score. I think this is going to give us an awful lot of latitude to get the votes. And then, Chris, I wish we were doing this on a bipartisan basis. I think it was a mistake right away saying we're going to do this partisan. That's where we're at. Maybe what we're going to have to do is we'll do our partisan bill, Democrats do theirs. We're not going to fix all these problems. And then maybe everybody will sit down and let's long-term fix the healthcare system. Let's start controlling healthcare costs. But you don't do that with a single-payer system. You do that by re-injecting consumer-driven free market competition. That's what restrains costs, improves quality and customer service. I know I come from the private sector. Free market system is a marvel. It works in other areas of our economy. We need to re-inject it into our healthcare system.
All right, Senator Johnson, I always appreciate you coming on with your perspective. It would be great to have more of these debates. It would be great for them to be bipartisan. We always invite you to do that here on New Day.
So bring me into the studio. I'll have my charts ready. Patient will lay this out so it's as understandable as possible, because it's really hard talking numbers just standing in front of a camera.
That is a guarantee. You tell me when you want to do it, we'll do it three times.
I don't know. I don't know. How does this sound to you guys? I don't know what to say, but this character here, I know about him. Are you saying it's fake news? Yeah, yous are fake news. And they want you paying for the illegals. That's what that was really what Obamacare was for. They wanted everybody to pay for the illegals that he was bringing in. Let us know what you think in the comments below. And again, thank you so much for watching.